Good afternoon, folks. Welcome to For SciTech. I see a lot of people out here that look like they may be students, and I know some faculty and some staff. How many of you are currently students at For SciTech? Raise your hand. All right. Well, great. Great. Thank you so much for coming. This SciTech lecture series is really a jewel that Russ Reed and his folks, Allison, and I saw Mary earlier. They've really done a great job putting this lecture series together. We've had over 40 speakers, 3,000 guests have attended our lecture series, and we've had topics ranging from regenerative medicine to radioactivity in Chernobyl. So it's really a great diversity of topics, and I am glad that you are here today because we have another great speaker, and I'm sure you all will learn much from listening to him. To introduce our speaker, I'm going to ask Nancy Johnston to come up and tell us all about him. We can't wait.
What a beautiful day. Thank you all for being here. So I represent the North Carolina Biotechnology Center. I have the opportunity to serve with Judy Berry in our Piedmont Triad office. And we have the great opportunity to work with individuals like Ski Chilton often. So it gives us great pleasure to be here to hear from him with his new book release. And we're really glad that you're here and that there are folks that are listening in on a web link. But without further ado, you know, how do you introduce such an accomplished and authentic individual as Ski Chilton? Mm-hmm. Well, I went to some of my best sources, my children, who often tell me, "Mom, be brief, use simple words," and the favorite from my 9-year-old daughter, "Use acronyms to help you remember." So with this advice, I proceed to introduce you to Dr. Chilton, better known as Ski to many. And so I need some audience participation to really make him feel welcomed. Okay, are you guys up for it? All right. So this room is actually divided in halves, but I want to get a little creative with Dr. Ayers here. We're going to do some math. We're going to divide it into thirds. So I'm not quite sure where to divide that line. But let's make an imaginary line in your mind. And so the left side of the room, we want to take about a third. The middle part of the room, Judy, you're going to be the middle, right? And then the right side of the room, okay? This is not going to be too hard. And you get to talk. So the left side of the room, when I point in your direction, I would like you to give me an S, okay? You want to practice?
S.
Good. Middle part of the room. When I point in your direction, I'd like for you to give me a K. So, okay. The right side of the room, when I point in your direction, I'd like for you to give me an I. Okay? Okay, so far the S's are winning, but we're not competitive. So I really appreciate that. So this is to remind you about Ski. So when you think about Ski Chilton, what are you going to think about? So let's start here.
S.
Okay. S stands for smart. He earned his PhD in biochemistry at Wake Forest University School of Medicine and did his postdoctoral fellowship in pharmacology at the University of Colorado School of Medicine. And he did all this after earning his bachelor's degree in biology and chemistry at Western Carolina. So he's what?
Smart.
Okay, next.
K.
Okay. Anyone who has interacted with Ski can attest to his kind demeanor. He is kind. He always finds a way to help others. And I mean that with great sincerity. He is the chairman of the board for the Persecution Project, which works with disaster and humanitarian relief in Sudan. And he also serves as the president of Heroes Helping Heroes, which provides health and wellness solutions to vulnerable children in the U.S. and around the world. So he is?
Kind.
Yes. So he is smart, and he is kind. And lastly,
I.
Okay, I. one of my favorites. He's an interesting innovator, and that's why he's here today to share with you. So he is an academic professor with over 140 scientific publications. He's an inventor holding 30 patents, an entrepreneur founding 4 organizations, including a biotech company, and a best-selling author with now 5 books. So here's the interesting part of the I. You will hear firsthand from him today about his great passion that's been captured in his new book called The Rewired Brain. It's written to help people reframe negative childhood experiences, overcome fears, experience emotional healing, and ultimately empower them to rewire their brain to be free and live fearlessly. So please join me in welcoming Ski to the podium.
That is absolutely the nicest introduction I have ever had. I'm crying. Thank
you're
you.
So kind.
Thank you so much. That was so sweet. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you for allowing me to be here. I'm going to start out with a video and then I'll proceed with my lecture.
Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. Do you know what I'm talking about? The Matrix. Do you want to know what it is? The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room. You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more. Let me tell you why you're here.
Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more. Well, this clip was from one of my favorite movies. It's the 1999 classic sci-fi, The Matrix. And this is the pivotal scene in the movie. And what's happening here is Morpheus is speaking to Neo. And he's offering Neo a blue pill or a red pill. Now, the blue pill is a matrix that Neo will live in. And he'll live the rest of his life in this matrix. And he'll not know he's in the matrix. He'll assume that he's making his own decisions. He assumes that he's responsible for the choices he makes. But really, with the blue pill, Neo has no choice. All the decisions are being made for Neo by a virtual computer matrix. The red pill is reality. It's a life based on truth. It's a life based on reality. It's a life filled with pain, but filled with truth, filled with purpose, and filled with meaning. I love the line, "If you choose this, let's see how deep the rabbit hole goes." Well, what I'm going to provide you evidence for today, and I'm going to provide evidence from several perspectives. I'm going to provide it from a science perspective. I study the human genome, and in particular, epigenetic changes in the human genome. And we also look at brain and brain plasticity. So I'm going to offer that to you. I'm going to offer a philosophical and theological bent to the human mind. But most of all, I'm going to provide you pain, an experience from pain, an experience from my pain. Modern neuropsychology unequivocally suggests that we all live in a matrix. We have these unconscious and these conscious minds, and these unconscious minds are absolutely so overwhelming that there's some question, in fact, there's a great deal of question of whether we actually have any free will at all, and are we responsible for our decisions? So many of you here today, and a lot of you are young, and I wish I'd gotten this talk at your age. I so wish I'd. Not only do I wish I'd gotten it at your age, but I wish I'd listened. Because if I'd gotten this talk at your age and I took the lessons that I learned from this, my life would have been a whole lot easier. It took me 50 years to begin to figure this out. So please, not just because it's me, do yourself a great favor and learn from this. Many of you have had negative, impactful, traumatic experiences that overwhelm you every day. Others have had a tragedy or a diagnosis that you or your family just can't move beyond. Many of you are believing lies about yourself that arise from your past that keep you from experiencing joy and freedom. Many of you are absolutely stuck in key aspects of your life. Maybe you keep on doing toxic relationships. Maybe you're stuck with sex and intimacy. There's a sex and intimacy chapter in that book. Maybe you're stuck with parenting issues. Many of you who have come here today and you're filled with fear, anxiety, and depression, and you absolutely have no idea why. That's the matrix that we live in. So the real question, and it's a real philosophical question. I studied philosophy for the past 2 years with one of the masters on the main campus, and we studied the issue of free will and whether humans really have it or not. We started with the ancient Greeks, and we went all the way through to the modern philosophers. But are we free or not? Most of us take for granted that the decisions that we make are really free decisions. And we have free choices in any given situation. But as the great philosopher Will Ferrell just recently tweeted, I got 99 problems and 86 of them are completely made up scenarios in my head that I'm stressing about for absolutely no logical reason. Perhaps in reality, it's like Henry David Thoreau, we live lives of quiet desperation. And you know, the part of that quote that I never got or I never looked at, and it's the saddest part, is we go to the grave with the song still in our hearts. We don't live optimal lives. So my book, The Rewired Brain, I'm so excited about this book. My other four books have been diet books, and they've been very important. But this book, this is my legacy book. This was the book that I was meant to write. And the first part of the book really talks about this issue of having two minds in one brain. These huge unconscious minds and these much, much smaller conscious minds from a perspective of all the neurological events that are taking place. And what happens when that unconscious mind becomes absolutely obsessed? Obsessed with fear, obsessed with the past, obsessed with childhood traumas, obsessed with whatever. And then the first part of the book ends with good news. Better news than we could have imagined is we have great capacity to change. And in fact, we have so much more capacity to change than we thought we had 20 years ago. And the science unequivocally, the genetics unequivocally backs that up. So change can occur anytime. Even if you're a 58-year-old man like me, change can occur at any time. You can turn your life around anytime you choose. So let me start with some basics here, and I promise I won't show too many of these science slides. But basically, as I've said, we have these two minds in one brain, and this gives rise to something called dual process reasoning. Now, in studying philosophy for 2 years, this was the concept that I absolutely fell in love with, because it was the concept that made sense to me. It made sense of how I could be so inconsistent in my life. It was the only thing that made sense. And basically the idea is that we have these two minds, the one mind being system one, commonly referred to in philosophical circles as system one. That's our unconscious minds. That's the blue pill. Now, this unconscious mind has a lot of advantages. It puts out 10,000 signals per second. It remembers child, adult traumas, relationship, parent attachments, and it hears every warning that you're hearing from politics, social media, everything that you're hearing, and it believes it. Because it has no capacity to determine if what it's hearing is true. It's not a very smart thing, it's just a warning system. And it's constantly shouting warnings. System two is our conscious mind. That's the red pill. So our unconscious mind is our limbic system and our reptilian brain. It's from here back. Our conscious mind is our neocortex, in particular our prefrontal cortex. This is our animal brain. This is our human brain. This is the thing that uniquely makes us human. So with our conscious minds, there are front brains. In theory, they have the capacity to monitor and override the unconscious, but it just wears us out. 10,000 a second and only 40 conscious that we can, it just wears us out. So it can only give rise to 40 signals per second. So my friends, if you come in here confused today, there is a reason. It is the matrix that we all live in. A few more things, and I'm not going to read all of these, but a few more things about System 1 and System 2. Again, System 1 being the unconscious mid to back brain, System 2 being the front brain. I want to go to the second one. It acts fast and effortlessly. System 1 unconscious is screaming all the time. It's saying the sky is falling. They are going to kill us. That person looks different than me. They're not part of my tribe. I'm going to have a racial, or I'm going to not feel safe with that person because they look different than me. It's constantly screaming. It's going, oh my gosh, I had this childhood trauma, and that childhood trauma is going to happen any minute now. Oh, my parents and I, this is the way we interacted. I had a really controlling parent. Well, I'm a controlling person. It does it all extraordinarily fast and effortlessly. Poor System 2 requires so much energy. System 2 is sitting there going, whoa, I'm getting all this stuff from my unconscious. How can I make any sense of it? How can I monitor all that's coming in, much less override all that's coming in? And quite frankly, most of us just don't do it. And from that perspective, we may think we have free will, we have none. We really have none. Now, this book is about turning that around. Now, I had some fun in the book. I compared System 1 to Homer on The Simpsons and System 2 to Spock or Data, depending on how old you are, on Star Trek. But, you know, System 1 is, he's the fun guy. He's the life of the party. He's unpredictable. He's a blast to hang out with in the evening. He's likely to act irrationally in the face of danger and make impulsive decisions without considering others. System 2 is like Spock and Data. Not very creative, not the most creative, spontaneous, not so fun-loving, but he can help you analyze and solve a very difficult problem. And he is very likely to remain calm in a stressful situation and do what's right by taking in all the input. Now, those are the two characters that are in your head. Now, I like to be Captain Kirk. Or Jean-Luc Picard. I think, you know, that's the balance. But those are the things that are going on in your mind. On a much more serious note, System 1 remembers and constantly warns of childhood traumas. If you have had abuse, I'm going to tell you about one of my prisons that dogged me for 50 years. It's not going to let you, it's not going to give up. You're going to get it constantly, and you're going to believe it. It doesn't forget, and here's where Freud did get it right. Freud was full of crap on a bunch of stuff, but with parent-child relationships and transference, Freud was spot on. Parent-child attachments unhealthy, devastating relationship, past relationships, that's transference that Freud talked about, unhealthy competitiveness, husband and a wife in a relationship, and for some reason they want to compete and destroy each other. People who are not from your tribe, people who look different than from you, you don't trust. Previous fearful events. System one is constantly. And even the most developed of us, even the most sophisticated of us, are struggling with all of this input. We're struggling to make sense out of it. Add on to that the impact of 24-hour news cycles, advertising, and politics. There's a great book called Brandwashed. Fear is by far the most effective way to sell a product. One of the security system just have some really rough-looking guys attacking a woman. So we are constantly being manipulated, and we're constantly exposed to things. And the reason it's so different now is we have 24 hours of this, and it's coming from every portion of the globe, and we're seeing beheadings as if it's happening in our own backyard. And guess what? Our System 1 thinks it is. Our System 1 can't differentiate. So it scares the crap out of us. Now, many people who are really into this think all this is justified. I was at a local restaurant in Pilot Mountain, my hometown, not so long ago. And I was at the table right next to me, and there were two old buddy guys there, and they were having a conversation. One goes, "Can you believe this place has just gone to hell? Society's just gone to hell. Used to be I could just not even lock my door and just walk around the neighborhood and never feel unsafe a bit. It's gone to hell. I'll double lock my doors now and I won't walk around the neighborhood without a gun." And I'm sitting there going, do you understand that crime is 3 times lower right now than it was in the mid-1970s, by every single parameter? We have never been safer. Your chances of being killed by a terrorist are the same as drowning in that commode in there. Believe it if you want, but the science unequivocally says no. But it affects us. It makes us distrust each other. It makes us hate each other. It makes us all these system ones. And it really is quite devastating. 100 million people died between 1914 and 1945. 100 million people died in that World War I, World War II period. I'm sorry, ISIS, we ain't even in the kiddie pool. So, from a science mathematical perspective, keep your perspective correct. People are trying to manipulate you. Now, this is what I think of when I think of my brain, or especially what my brain used to be. I was in Los Angeles not long ago, and I got on the 405. Now, 405 is the largest highway in the country, 16 lanes. Now, I got on the 405, and I just went on, and I started moving into center lanes. I'm going to tell you what, a country boy gets on the 405, he ain't getting off the 405 till he gets to San Diego, because he can't get back outside the lanes. He can't find an exit. He can't get to an exit ramp. Well, when we have fear, when we have abuse and neglect, when we have parent-child attachments, when we have unhealthy competition, when we have all of these things feeding into our unconscious minds unabated. That's the 405. You can't get off of it. That's the world you live in. So, about 8 years ago, I had a red pill, blue pill moment. And the moment was, on one hand, all of these wonderful things that Nancy said about me to introduce me. I love the acronym SCI. That's great. All of these wonderful things on one hand, and on the other hand, I was coming through a second divorce. We were dealing with a family tragedy that none of us could get beyond. We were hurting each other in massive ways and consistent ways. So on one hand, yes, I'm in Sudan and Darfur. I'm doing the greatest things in the world for orphans. On the other hand, I'm sitting here destroying the people I love the most. Why would someone as smart as me be doing that? Why would I be living a life like that? And if your blue pill, red pill moment comes, are you living a consistent life? I'm going to use a lot of terms from Alcoholics Anonymous or Narcotics Anonymous just because I'm such a fan of that organization. Has your life become unmanageable? Do you know who you are and what you're passionate about? I'm going to tell you, if you ever come into my, just a warning, any of you who are students here, and if you go to and get your undergraduate and you want to go to med school or you want to go to graduate school, you ever come into my office, I'll tell you what my first question is going to be. It's going to be, what are you passionate about? And I can tell you 90% of the students go, oh, moving test tubes around. I said, get out, get out. You got to be passionate about something besides chemistry. You got to be passionate. There's something. Come on. So who are you and what are you passionate about? Have you had recognized childhood events that may be impacting you? Are you a control freak? You may be driven by system one. Not maybe. You are driven by system one if you're a control freak. Do you feel lonely much of the time? For me, there were several early events. There's one I won't talk about except to say it was a sexual abuse as I was a child by a family friend. But there was a second one that was particularly devastating as well, and it was, I was severely dyslexic. Couldn't read coming out of high school. Still put a child's book in front of me and tell me to read it, and I can't read it. But I started out in a house without a bathroom on a tobacco farm, and back then in the 70s, if you were that slow and couldn't read, you all went to the same white building way over next to the school, and it's called the special building, or in some cases, the retarded trailer, whatever. And I don't even like to use that word, but I spent 3 years in that building. And that building says a couple of things to you. It says you're absolutely unworthy and you're absolutely unlovable. And as my sister has always said, the retarded trailer can do one of two things for you. It can either destroy you or it can make you great. For me, I got a 6-year PhD in 3 years. It's still a record at Wake Forest. I'm not bragging about it, but the reason I did it was I was afraid that the lady who was the head of the retarded trailer was going to put me back in the retarded trailer. because I wasn't smart enough. I wasn't worthy enough. I wasn't lovable. Worked with a Nobel Prize winner. Moved through the ranks at Johns Hopkins faster than anyone. When you're doing those things as a result of a fear of failure, and in particular a fear of being worthy or unworthy, that brings no joy. You may be saying, I still own the record. It brings no joy. It brings, all of that is system one. But what it also did in my relationships is it said, you are not worthy of love, and so you must constantly do things in every relationship, and in some relationships, you must choose people that you need to rescue because that's the only way that you'll be lovable. Quite frankly, folks didn't have a chance. None of us have a chance. Those are the codependent relationships. And those are addictions, and they're devastating. Well, I'm going to switch just a little bit, and I'm taking a little too much time, so I'm going to move a little faster. The great news is you can change. You can change. And for a lot of years, we didn't think you could change. Up until 40 years ago, we said, okay, here's the human genome. You got 3 billion base pairs. You got 23,000 chromosomes. And those 23,000 chromosomes are going to pretty much determine how many neurons you have and your brain connections. And you're going to have a few childhood things. And that's going to determine how many brain connections you have. And you're stuck. By the time you're a teenager, you're stuck. Yeah, that's it. So all your behavioral tendencies, everything after that, you're stuck. Nothing can change. Brains are static organisms. However, in the last 20 years, there's been the emergence of a new genetics. And this new genetics is something we could never have imagined. This new genetics says, as I interact with my environment, that changes my DNA. It puts methylation tags, acetyl tags, all over my DNA, and that changes which genes are expressed, and it changes how much of the genes are expressed. So, if you guys are enjoying this talk, I hope you are, and if it's meaningful to you, then it's changing your DNA. And that's putting new methyl groups in CpG sites and new acetyl groups in histones, and all of a sudden, if this talk is meaningful to you, your DNA in your brain is being changed at this very moment, and that will in turn change the circuitry of your brain. You hear enough of me, you may really have circuitry changes. I'm not sure that's a good thing. My family's in the back there, and they're just looking like, I don't know, you don't want too much of that. But the point is, we went from this static DNA model to this unbelievable freedom that came with the epigenetic model. Now, again, I won't go through this slide, but epigenetics changed everything. And in particular with our brains, it changed which neurons that we're going to form connections with. I mean, we nerds have this saying, neurons that fire together, wire together. Well, that's true. So those signals, those pathways that you use the most get stronger, epigenetically get stronger. Those that you use the least go away. Wow. Now we're getting some freedom in the system. But here was the big one. Here in my opinion, is the most important scientific observation that's been made in the past 50 years. It is that not only does your environment change your DNA, but your very thoughts change your DNA. See, I believe within each of us there's a self, and that self has thoughts. And those thoughts, our very thoughts, change our DNA and our brain wiring. And we can now, with cognitive behavioral therapy, we show it over and over and over again. We can put you in an MRI and we can make you think things for weeks and weeks and weeks, and we can completely change the wiring of your brain. So your very thoughts have extraordinary power to change you, to change who you are, and to change what you are. So if you have these emotional addictions that are wired in your brain, like me, I'm not lovable, I'm not worthy. Connect, and I have a higher power, I'm a person of faith, but connect whatever, and all of a sudden, think long enough that you're worthy, believe strong enough, long enough that you're worthy, that you're lovable, you become worthy and lovable. If you want to become a nicer person, think about becoming a nicer person. Think about it long enough and you become a nicer person. If you want to sit there and go, you know, I'm really not capable of being a nicer person, then you'll stay an ass. It's up to you. You know, this was recognized early on in the 19th century, and I love this. Plant a thought, reap a word. Plant a word, reap an action. Plant an action, reap a habit. Plant a habit, reap a character. Plant a character, reap a destiny. It all starts with your thoughts. You want to be better? You want to be different? It all starts with your thoughts. Your thoughts will eventually lead to actions, and if done enough, will lead to habits, which will change who you are. And that's not just some hypothetical, mystical bullcrap. That is changing your very DNA and subsequent wiring that will be responsible for you changing. I love this. It really comes down to this. A Native American elder once described his own inner struggles. He said, inside me there's a mean dog, an evil dog, a good dog is inside of me. And the person listening said, well, which dog wins the fight? And he goes, the one I feed the most. Inside of you, what will win the fight is the dog that you feed the most. So the real question then is, who do you want to be? You want to be the red pill? You want to be the blue pill? It's really up to you. If you do nothing about your life, you by default will take the blue pill. If you live mindful and meaningful, then you will take the red pill. And the objective is, yes, the 405 will still be there, but you're going to build this other major 405, this system 2 405 that can lead to freedom. And the stronger that becomes, the more it can monitor your system 1 and the more that it can override your system 1. I don't know how many of you, and I don't know why I just thought about this, but I'll just come up and I'll be in the bathroom sometime and I'll go, God, this sucks. I don't even know what sucks. What caused me to say that? Am I crazy? Do you guys do that? The thing is, when you do that, if your system two is monitoring that, they're going, I don't know where that come from, but it really doesn't suck. It's really a good life. It's a happy life. I don't know where in the world that come from, but you know what? Now that ain't right. I really live a good, great life. You know, part two of the book goes through chapters, what it means to be human, morality, when tragedy strikes. Josh Chilton, my son, is sitting right back there. He wrote half of When Tragedy Strikes. Facing the greatest parent, challenge parenting, it's not you, it's me. Intimacy and sex. So, I'm going to talk about one thing, and I think it's very, very important. So, with regard to the second part of the book, actually two things. Number one is, I wrote this book proposal and several publishers bid on it and Baker Books bought it, and it had a chapter in there going, what does it mean to be human? What it means to be human. I was so mad at myself. Who the heck writes a chapter called What It Means to Be Human? What it means to be human? Who's gonna... I mean, I sit there a month and did not write one word. But my dad, even though we were on a tobacco farm, he raised me on soul and R&B music, Motown. And so every morning I put on my iPad, my Bose system, and it is rocking. Soul R&B, the Soul R&B channel. And about a year ago when I was writing this chapter, this particular chapter, I kept hearing the song, and I couldn't figure out what I was going to write about. And I excuse me, the advertisement. We will get over that. Here's what it means to be human.
Hey, say, wait a minute. Where are you going with that suitcase? Hey, wait a minute. Listen. Well, you don't have to answer. Just listen. I don't mind when you say that you're going away. I just don't want to be lonely. And I don't care if we share only moments a day. I just don't want to be lonely.
And that song just kept playing in the background. And I said, that's it. Our human condition is loneliness. One of my favorite philosophers, and he and Freud went at each other. But he is absolutely one of my favorite. And he wrote, the awareness of himself as a separate entity, the awareness of his own short lifespan, of the fact that without his will he is born, against his will he dies, that he will die before those of whom he loves, or they before him, the awareness of his loneliness, his separateness, his helplessness before the forces of nature and society, all this makes his separate, disunited existence an unbearable prison. What it means to be human is to be lonely. And even if we've got people all around us, I've had to deal with two primary cancers. Guess what? When you go in that radiation, you go in that chemotherapy, it's just you. It's just you. And I may have all the faith in the world that there's a heaven out there, and I do, but I ain't took that journey yet. So all of our lives we spend dealing with this loneliness, and all of these chapters that I go through are really written in the context of that first principle. That first principle, and how that we deal with that first principle in good and difficult ways, but how important it is. For me, the solution to my loneliness was found in Africa. I have a t-shirt that says, I need Africa more than Africa needs me. Because what Africa taught me was that if I loved without expecting anything in return, if I risked my life without expecting anything in return, the universe would give love back. And it would give love back in ways that I could not even imagine. And that became the key to my loneliness. I want to quickly, in the relationship chapter, I'm sure you've heard this, hurt people hurt people. If you've ever been to counseling, you've heard it. What so often happens in the relationships is we have these two people, especially in second marriages, first marriages, whatever, and they're bringing their, people call it baggage, but they're bringing their system one issues. They're bringing their system one past relationships. They're bringing their system one childhood traumas. They're bringing their system one parent-child relationships, and they're both bringing them. And they're, the moment the other person in the relationship does anything like the previous relationship, they go, oh, see, that's the same person. It's absolutely the same person. If in my second marriage there had been a counselor who had said, Ski, don't you understand, and there were three counselors involved, it's not your fights. It's not, you're not even fighting with each other. You're fighting with your past, and you're hitting each other. It's so critical to understand this and understand that in these relationships, one then has to begin to shoot at the dysfunctions and not each other. The third part of the book has three chapters in it. For me, the last three slides, my steps to getting better was hitting bottom. The bottom was, if I was going to live an inconsistent life, I was a man of honor and I would die before I would do that. I simply would not do that anymore. That was my rock bottom. To restart at 50 years old, and in my chapter 11, there's a who am I and why am I here? What is my purpose here? Chapter and exercises to determine that. That came next. I figured out that what turned my crank, I was passionate about compassion. And as long as I was doing something compassionate, I was gonna have a great life. But that took me understanding. I realized that I had to surrender in this AA. I had to surrender that 405. I believe that you can't be in control. There is a reason that the second step of AA is I surrender this to a higher power. You're giving addictions to a higher power, but these are just as powerful addictions. These emotional addictions are just as powerful as any chemical addiction has ever been. So you're surrendering those. I took my responsibility for my part. I then begin to use my own thoughts through prayer and meditation to construct new mega superhighways to much more beautiful places. I found an outstanding counselor who focused on cognitive behavioral therapy, better known for me as kick your butt ski therapy. If you're going to therapy right now and you're not being challenged, you probably are not in the right therapy. It's hard to change. It's very hard to change. This took 5-6 years. I forgave others and myself, and I asked others to forgive me. I prayed for a miracle of relationship restoration. I didn't get that miracle, but I got other miracles. And particularly, I got the insight for the concept of the rewired brain. That was my miracle. And it was a great miracle. And it was a great journey. And it is a great journey. Thank you for listening to me this evening. I really appreciate you being here. I'll be glad to take questions. I'm going to give away 2 books, too, for people who have. But first, any questions? Yes, Judy.
How long did it take you to write this book?
2 years.
How long were you stuck in that one chapter?
A little over a month. But it took 2 years, but it really, the writing of the book itself, that was 9 months. The research for the book was the preceding whatever, but 9 months. I love the beach. I love the ocean. People go, Myrtle Beach, yeah, you know, that was my happy place growing up. So I went 27 straight weekends to Myrtle Beach. I stayed in a no-tail motel that looked at the ocean. I'd go in Friday at lunch, and I wouldn't come out until Sunday night. And so it was a really about 20 hours a day, but every weekend at the beach or on a we have a sailboat, either on our sailboat or at the beach. Yes. You know, I am very much for it. I mean, I help develop drugs for inflammatory. I was at a certain point on a very high dose of antidepressants and hypertension medications. I'm no longer. I'm not saying that everyone will get the same results. I'm not an MD, so I feel real comfortable and uncomfortable in answering that question. For me, the right way of thinking, a better way of thinking, took care of a world of health problems. Stress related to system one, and this is something I study all the time, know a lot about, activates the fight and flight system, activates the cortisol system, dramatically elevates systemic inflammation, and then all the diseases associated with it. So living in fear, living in system one, living in that world, watching the social media, watching the politics, watching it all, and allowing it to impact you is dramatically, negatively impacting your health through the stress cortisol axis. Josh, what's up, man? Josh is saying, why is, if system one is so bad, why is it there? You know, why, from an evolutionary perspective, has it hung on? Well, it's a little bit about like the modern Western diet. You know, I think of up until 200 years ago, the average lifespan was 35. You know, several thousand years ago, the average lifespan was 29. You were going to die of another tribe. You were going to have to fight for your food. You needed everything, every warning system that System 1 had to survive. You were going to need your fight and flight responses. But we're not going to evolve fast enough to get rid of that System 1 just because we don't need it anymore. And in fact, if social media, politics, all of this 24-hour news cycle, Wolf Blitzer, breaking news, as if your next breath depended on it. If you buy into that junk food, if you buy into that junk food that has no basis behind it, we're safer than we've ever been, three times safer than 1970s. Then you're going to continue to utilize that, but it's going to damage you. The stress cycle will damage you. But as Josh points out, there is a reason. And in my sex chapter, I mean, System 1 is, there's some fun sex with System 1. And you put System 1 sex with System 2, creativity, and all of a sudden, whoa, we have the most, you know, creative system that you could possibly imagine. So it is, and Josh is going, did he have to mention the sex? But he's just shaking his head. But, you know, but at the same time, it's the balance. And you saw the highway. It is the balance. We still need to be warned. But we just have to realize that the warnings often aren't accurate, and our System 2 has to validate what we're being warned against. And if it's not, then we monitor it and we put it away. Did I answer your question, Josh? Okay, I got the thumb up. That's difficult from him. Any other questions? Well, thank you. I went a little over, but thank you so much for your time. And please live happy, be joyous, be free. The one thing about this book I think that was most important to me is, if you're a person of faith like me, I believe there are two principles that are beyond all other. And one is love, and the other is freedom. We all desperately want to be free. And we can't be free in these minds that are so constrained by our fears and our past. And that's what we all just want to be free. When I'm out on that sailboat, wow, we just want to be free. It's so critical. Okay, let's give away a couple of books.
Before we do that, we'd like to thank you first.
I don't know if you can you hear me? I don't speak very loud, but our fearless leader isn't here. He's out of town on business, but he wrote a personal note I'd like to share with you real quick.
Yeah. Here, you can use this one, I think. If I can.
Must be right here. We'll have to share. I was saying that our leader, Russ Reed, isn't here today. He's out of town on business, but he wrote a personal note that I'd like to share with you real quick. And he said, on behalf of the college and the staff, faculty, students, and administration, thank you for sharing your story with us today. I want to know that you were one of the first SciTech speakers, so we are very pleased that you came back to speak with us. On a personal note from Russ, he said, Ski, I'm truly sorry that I was not able to be with you today. I'm in San Francisco on grant business. Many in this room today do not know that our friendship goes back to 2001, an incredible 15 years. I'm very grateful for your mentorship over these years and knowledge that you researched and shared with me regarding suppressing inflammation, which has helped extend my life to be a high quality and productive one, well beyond a stroke close to 10 years ago. All the best. Thank you so much, Russ.
I love Russ Reed. He is my hero.
I don't need a mic because I can speak. Okay. On behalf of SciTech and the National Center, we'd like to present you with this beautiful.
It is beautiful. Oh my goodness. I don't think I got a. I didn't get one last. This is awesome.
It's the second time around.
Oh, this is awesome. Thank you. Look up. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, now we can do the wrappers. Look at your wrappers.
Okay. 61932. 61932.
Six digits.
Yeah, there is.
619. 6932 8. Oh, 6932 8. I'm sorry. I'm dyslexic. It is 619328. Okay, yay. And 619444. Six, one, nine, four, four, four. Okay, going back in.
Jennifer, it might have been your friend that came with you.
619440. 619440. Okay. Wow, okay. Can't give away a book. 619438. Yay! And I would be glad to, the books are $15 a piece. If you would like to buy one, I'd be glad to sign it for you. Absolutely. And be happy to sign it. Be happy to sell you one. They're available at Barnes & Noble, Amazon, et cetera, et cetera. Thank you.